Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel, this beautiful book of Kings. We're going to pick it up today, 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 10. We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you'd care to. We're getting ready to have an old-fashioned Bible study here at the chapel. We'd left off in our last lecture, and, you know, God sent prophet after prophet to the nation of Israel, the 10 tribes to the north, trying to get their attention. And it looks like someone would have been smart enough to figure out, you know, let's think back. When did we start having all of this trouble? And they would have been pretty easy for them to determine. It was when Jeroboam made the two golden calves and said, you guys don't need to go down to Jerusalem and worship the Lord there. Worship your golden calves that brought your ancestors out of the land of Egypt. Well, Ahab was not one to listen to the prophets. His queen Jezebel, certainly not one to listen to the prophets of the Lord. She liked to listen to the prophets of Baal and the prophets of the groves. Well, God sent an oppressor to Israel, his name Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, and along with 32 vassal kings. Probably they were vassal because he had conquered their nations. And it was a very formidable army came up against Samaria. And Ben-Hadad sent word to Ahab, your gold is mine, your silver is mine, all of your wives are mine, even your children are mine. And Ahab sent some of his gold, some of his silver, maybe a wife or two and one or two of his kids, to Ben-Hadad and said, there you go, it's all yours. And Ben-Hadad sent word back to him going, I didn't mean part of your gold and silver, I meant all of your gold and silver. Well, Ahab was having trouble finding any backbone to stand up to Ben-Hadad, but he called the elders, his counselors together of Samaria, and they said, don't give him any more. Tell him that's it. You're not going to do it, and we've got your back if you'll stand up to him. And that's where we left off in our last lecture, was that Ahab had sent word to Ben-Hadad that the gold and silver I've sent to you is going to have to be good enough because that's all you're getting. Will Ben-Hadad be satisfied with that? Let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua Jesus' precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up, 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 10. And it reads, and Ben-Hadad sent unto him, this being Ahab, and said, the God, small g, do so unto me, this is a solemn oath, and more also, if the dust of Samaria shall suffice for handfuls for all the people that follow me. And this kind of loses it in the translation. What Ben-Hadad is saying is that those who follow me, in other words, those who are in my army, are so numerous that there's not enough spoil in Samaria to satisfy all of them. And that when we get done with you ransacking Samaria, all that's going to be left is a few handfuls of dust, trying to intimidate the weak-minded Ahab. And until the elders of Samaria kind of told Ahab to stand up to Ben-Hadad, he had been very weak. Now he fires back a good one in the next verse, though. And the king of Israel answered and said, tell him, let not him that girdeth on his harness boast himself as he that putteth it off. This is a proverb, a figure of speech, if you will. And what it means is Ahab is telling Ben-Hadad that it's not he that puts his pants on to go to war who should boast. It's he who takes the pants away from the enemy that has the right to boast. In other words, I'm going to take your pants down and spank you, Ben-Hadad. That won't make Ben-Hadad very happy, verse 12. And it came to pass when Ben-Hadad heard this message, he was drinking, he and the kings in the pavilions, in the tents, that he said unto his servants, set yourselves in array, and they set themselves in array against the city, against Samaria, the capital of the 10 tribes to the north. Now, you know, when he's there drinking in these tents with his drinking buddies, and then a word comes from the messengers, hey, Ahab said he's going to take your pants down and spank your bottom, that wouldn't go over very good in front of the drinking buddies. That would be kind of embarrassing to Ben-Hadad. And he's saying now, to set yourselves in array, that's let's get it on, it's wartime. Verse 13, and behold, there came a prophet, this is a prophet of the Lord, not of Baal, unto Ahab, king of Israel, saying, thus saith the Lord, hast thou seen all this great multitude? The Syrian army was formidable. Behold, I will deliver it into thine hand this day, and thou shalt know I am the Lord. Now note that this prophet was not sent when the Ben-Hadad first made the threat. Your gold, your silver, your wives, and your children are all mine. God didn't send a prophet until Ahab got a little backbone and stood up to Ben-Hadad. Maybe Ahab is finally starting to get it. If you do things God's way, he'll bless you. He'll give you the victory over your enemies. I wouldn't be too quick to think Ahab has got it, though. Verse 14. And Ahab said, by whom? And did we get verse 13? Yes, we did. And Ahab said, by whom? As he turned and looked behind him to see if anybody was standing behind him, no doubt. And he said, thus saith the Lord, even by the young men of the princes of the provinces. Then he said, who shall order the battle? Question. And he answered, thou, you, Ahab, are going to be in charge. And of course, with God on your side, even Ahab could be a good commander in chief. These young men of the princes of the prophets were servants, if you will. They were the fruits of Elijah's efforts to bring some sense to the people of Israel. We're going to see that they number 232 in the next verse. Verse 15. Then he numbered the young men of the princes of the provinces, and they were 232. And after them he numbered all the people, even all the children of Israel, being 7,000. And you have a type here for God's election of this, the fig tree generation. There were 7,000 who did not bow a knee to Baal at the time of Elijah. There are 7,000 who will not bow a knee to the Antichrist. They won't worship him. And what are we to learn from this? Well, you know, and this says all the children of Israel were 7,000. All the children of Israel would have been a whole lot more than 7,000. These 7,000, as I said a moment ago, are only those who did not bow a knee to Baal. But 7,232 are going to be going up in thousands of thousands in the Syrian army. And what we can learn from this is that we don't need to be afraid. If God is on our side, we have the victory. God and one are a majority. If God is on your side, that's enough. Verse 16. And they went out at noon, but Ben-Hadad was drinking himself drunk in the pavilions. Seems like he spent a lot of time hitting the bottle, doesn't it? He and the kings, the 32 kings that helped him, these vassal kings. And, you know, drunks don't make very good leaders of an army. Drunks do good to stand up. They talk nonsense rather than common sense. So this is not a good situation for the Syrian army. Their leaders are out getting drunk before the battle. Verse 17. And the young men of the princes of the provinces went out first, the 232. And Ben-Hadad sent out, and they told him, saying, there are men come out of Samaria. They're marching towards the armies of Syria. They're not running from the armies of Syria. They don't appear to be afraid. There's no need to be afraid when God is on your side. Verse 18. And he said, Ben-Hadad, whether they be come out for peace, take them alive, or whether they be come out for war, take them alive. And this is said in arrogance. He's saying there's only 232 of them, so whether they come in peace or to make war, don't kill them, take them alive. He's going to be thinking a lot different when this is over. Verse 19. So these young men of the princes of the provinces came out of the city, and the army which followed them, 7,232 leaders of the military. The word Ahab means uncle if you translate it rather than transliterate it. But it's not going to be Ahab that's saying uncle. It's going to be Ben-Hadad that's going to be saying uncle. Ben-Hadad is about to have his britches taken away from him. Verse 20. And they slew every one his man, and the Syrians fled, and Israel pursued them. And Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, escaped on an horse with a horseman. He's running scared. Again, God in one is the majority. When God says that I'll give you the victory, he means it. 21. And the king of Israel went out and smote the horses and chariots and slew the Syrians with great slaughter. And Ahab shouldn't really be taking a lot of credit for this. He was having trouble finding enough backbone to stand up to Ben-Hadad until the elders of Samaria talked some sense into him, and God sent the prophet saying, I'll be with you and I'll give you the victory over Ben-Hadad and the Syrians. Always give credit where it belongs. In this case, it belongs with the Lord. Verse 22. And the prophet came to the king of Israel, to Ahab. After the battle was over, the prophet came back and said unto him, go strengthen thyself, and mark and see what thou doest. Be on guard. For at the turn of the year, next spring, the king of Syria will come up against thee. God knows the mind and heart of all. And he's warning Ahab, don't let your guard down. You condition your men and keep them in shape, because at the beginning of the next year, the spring, the return of the year in spring, Ben-Hadad and his armies are going to be back. Do you think God would be right? 23. And the servants of the king of Syria said unto him, and here they're going to be talking about they're back home licking their wounds, trying to figure out what went wrong. they're going to come to the conclusion that there were two main reasons that the armies of Israel were able to defeat them. The first reason, their gods, small g in plural, are gods of the hills. Therefore, they were stronger than we, but let us fight against them in the plain, and surely we shall be stronger than they. Now, here, that would be offensive to our Heavenly Father. You see, he's not only a God of the hills or the mountains, he's also the God of the plains, he's the God of the heavens, he's the God of earth. So limiting him to being a God of the hills would be an insult to our Heavenly Father. The second reason for the failure, verse 24, and do this thing, take the kings away, the 32 vassal kings, the drunks, get the drunks out of here, every man out of his place, and put captains in their rooms, in their places. In other words, don't leave the military in the control of a bunch of drunks. Get some real military disciplined captains in here to run the military, and things will go better when we attack in the spring. 25. And number thee an army like the army that thou hast lost, just exactly the same number, horse for horse and chariot for chariot, and we will fight against them in the plain, and surely we shall be stronger than they. And he hearkened unto their voice and did so. Again, he didn't realize he's dealing with a God of heaven and earth, not just the God of the hills. Verse 26, and it came to pass at the return of the year that Ben-Hadad numbered the Syrians and went up to Aphek. Aphek means fortress or strength, to fight against Israel. This location probably east of Galilee, no doubt it was in the plains, and that's one of the reasons his advisors told him they lost the previous go-around. This time they were going to fight in the plains, not in the hills. 27. And the children of Israel were numbered, they were mustered for war, and were all present. This word present actually could be translated, they were victualed, meaning that they had food supplies and weapons, and went against them. And the children of Israel pitched before them like two little flocks of kids, but the Syrians filled the country. There were Syrians as far as the eye could see filling the plain. And in contrast, you had two little groups of the people of Israel that looked like little flocks of the sheep or the goats, the kids. Verse 28, and there came a man of God, another true prophet, and spake unto the king, to Ahab, of Israel, and said, thus saith the Lord, because the Syrians have said, the Lord is God of the hills, but he is not God of the valleys or the plains, therefore will I deliver all this great multitude into thine hand, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. And it looks like Ahab would finally get it. But, you know, it looks like he would have learned, but I think he's got too much selfishness, too much influence from Jezebel. Verse 29, and they pitched one over against the other 7 days, sizing each other up. And so it was that in the 7th day the battle was joined, and the children of Israel slew of the Syrians 100,000 footmen in 1 day. 100,000 of the armies of Syria slain in 1 day. God in control. Verse 30. But the rest of the armies of the Syrians, fled to Aphek into the city. They probably thought, that was close, now we're safe. And there a wall fell upon 27,000 of the men that were left. Escaped the battle, the war, but the wall got them. And Ben-Hadad fled and came into the city into an inner chamber. This means he went from room to room and then went into a chamber within a chamber. Ben-Hadad is hiding. 31. And his servant said unto him, Behold now, we have heard that the kings of the house of Israel are merciful, that they're kind kings. Let us, I pray thee, put sackcloth on our loins. Whoops, Ben-Hadad lost his breeches for sackcloth. And robes upon our heads. This is more like ropes around our necks, indicating total submission. Someone who had a slave might be seen walking around with a rope around the slave's neck, indicating total dominance. And go out to the king of Israel, peradventure he will save thy life. Maybe Ahab won't kill you. And you see, at this time, remember what Ben-Hadad told Ahab. All your gold is mine, all your silver is mine, your wives are mine, and your children are mine. And now Ben-Hadad is changing his tune and his tone. Verse 32. So they girded sackcloth on their loins and put ropes on their heads, around their necks more likely, and came to the king of Israel and said, Thy servant Ben-Hadad saith, I pray thee, let me live. And he said, Is he yet alive? This is Ben-Hadad or Ahab replying. Question, he is my brother. And of course, they're not brothers of the same family. Ben-Hadad is the king of Syria. Ahab is the king of Israel. So their relationship could be seen as brothers. But notice the wording of this. They said, Thy servant Ben-Hadad saith. Is this the man who was threatening Samaria to make it just handfuls of dust would be left? 33. Now the men did diligently observe whether anything would come from him, from Ahab in other words, and did hastily catch it. In other words, well, let's go on. And they said, Thy brother Ben-Hadad. We heard with our own ears, Ahab said, Thy brother Ben-Hadad. That sounds good. Then he said, Go ye, bring him. Then Ben-Hadad came forth to him, and he caused him to come up into his chariot. God said, I'll give you the enemy into your hand. I don't think God gave him the enemy to invite him up into his chariot. Ahab's an idiot. There's just no other way to put it. After being threatened the way that Ben-Hadad threatened him, and it was his privilege, his right, to put Ben-Hadad to death. No, he's not doing that. He's not taking the victory that God gave him. He's acting like Ben-Hadad has been his lifelong friend. 34. And Ben-Hadad said unto him, this is to Ahab, the cities which my father took from your father, these would be the northern cities that were taken of Naphtali from the previous kings, I will restore, and thou shalt make streets for thee in Damascus, as my father made in Samaria. Then said Ahab, I will send thee away with this covenant, with this oath. So he made a covenant with him and sent him away. God's plan was to destroy the enemies of Israel, and Ahab is letting them go. What Ben-Hadad was saying about I'll make streets for thee in Damascus, Damascus, of course, being the capital of Syria. Now, what he's saying is, we'll let you name the streets and the boulevards in Damascus whatever name you choose, like my father named the streets in Samaria. And this is, you know, these were bitter enemies. And he should have punished Ben-Hadad with death, but he let him go. Next spring, he'll be back. Well, in 3 years, the Syrians will be back, and Ahab will lose his life in battle. Verse 35. And a certain man of the sons of the prophets said unto his neighbor, in other words, to another student prophet, in the word of the Lord, in other words, this is the word of the Lord, smite me, I pray thee. And the man refused to smite him. And when a prophet gets an instruction from God, he should do it, no questions asked. But he didn't do what the other prophet asked. He refused God's command. But what we see here is Ahab is being set up to sentence himself, is what is going on here. Verse 36. Then said he, the first prophet, unto him, because thou hast not obeyed the voice of the Lord, behold, as soon as thou art departed from me, a lion shall slay thee. And as soon as he was departed from him, a lion found him and slew him. You remember back in chapter 13 of 1 Kings, where we had the disobedient prophet. You remember what happened to him? A lion slew him for not obeying the word of God. So this should be a lesson to all the prophets. It's a warning to them, a very serious thing not to obey the word of God. Verse 37, then he found another man, the disciple of the prophets, and said, smite me, I pray thee. And the man smote him, so that in smiting him, he wounded him. In other words, he drew blood, which was the intent of the first prophet. I don't know if the second one that he approached and asked to hit him saw what happened to the first prophet that he asked to hit him that refused, that the lion killed him, and he was glad to oblige, maybe. But he drew blood. Verse 38. So the prophet departed and waited for the king. He's waiting on Ahab by the way, and disguised himself with ashes upon his face. And ashes is a terrible translation that should have been translated. He disguised himself with bandages upon his face. In other words, he had this prophet strike him to draw blood and then placed a bandage over it. And what he's going to do is feign or pretend like he was wounded in the battle with the Syrians. Verse 39. And as the king passed by, he cried unto the king. And he, this being the young prophet, said, thy servant went out into the midst of the battle between the 10 tribes and Syria. And behold, a man turned aside, one of our fellow soldiers, a soldier of Israel, and brought a man unto me, this being a Syrian prisoner, and said, keep this man, if by any means he be missing, then shall thy life be for his life, or else thou shalt pay a talent of silver. In other words, the lesson is that Ben-Hadad should have held Ben-Hadad or killed him, at least held him as a prisoner. Verse 40. And as thy servant was busy here and there with the battle, not paying attention, he was gone. He escaped. The Syrian prisoner escaped. And the king of Israel, Ahab, said unto him, so shall thy judgment be. Thyself hast decided it. You sentenced yourself. And guess what? Ahab just sentenced himself as well. Similar thing happened to David as what happened to Ahab in 2 Samuel chapter 12. After David had sent Uriah the Hittite to the hottest front and gotten him killed in battle, he murdered him, God sent a prophet, Nathan, to David. This is in 2 Samuel chapter 12. And he put a parable before David. He goes, there was a man who had thousands and thousands of sheep. And then there was another man who only had one sheep. And when company came and he wanted to prepare a feast, did he take one of his thousands and thousands of sheep to slay it to prepare for a meal? No, he took the man's who had only one sheep. And David said, who is this man? As sure as I live, he'll die. And Nathan said, the man is you, because you took Bathsheba, the only wife that Uriah the Hittite had. He made his own sentence, verse 41. And he hasted and took the ashes, this is the young prophet, he took the bandages away from his face. And the king of Israel discerned him that he was of the prophets. He recognized him as being as one of the disciples of the prophets. He had no doubt that the prophecy would probably come to pass. Verse 42. And he said unto him, thus saith the Lord, because thou hast let go out of thy hand a man whom I appointed. This means that he had banned him. In other words, well, to utter destruction. The Lord said, destroy Ben-Hadad. Don't invite him up into your chariot and then let him go home with a covenant of friendship. Therefore thy faith shall go for his, thy life shall go for his life, and thy people for his people. And there's not an option of paying one talent of silver, as the young disciple of the prophets proposed when he was correcting Ahab. Verse 43 to conclude the chapter. And the king of Israel went to his house heavy and displeased and came to Samaria. He decided to go home to Jezebel and lick his wounds. Well, in our next chapter, when we come back tomorrow, we'll be showing the true nature of Ahab and Jezebel. You don't want to miss that one. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13:23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S. and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Don't ask questions about a specific denomination, organization, or denomination by name. We teach God's Word in a positive manner. Throwing out negative about others, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the correcting, the teaching, the correcting, and the healing, fully capable of all three. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. And with that, if you got a prayer request, well, you don't need a telephone number. You don't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I encourage you to make time to talk to your Father. Let him know that you love him. And when you have made your decisions in your life, seek his counsel. Ask him for a sign. There's nothing wrong with that, like Gideon asked throughout the fleece for God to give him a sign. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. You know their problems, addictions to alcohol, drugs, Father, financial difficulties. You know, Father, if it is your will, a special blessing on these. And we lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions and see what's on the mind of folks. First up today, we have Jackie in New York. Matthew 24, verses 19 and 20. I can't read that. I am pregnant with a nursing along. Okay. Satan's lies. Flight in winter means harvested out of season. Hebrews chapter 4, I can't read your writing, or Sabbath, that is Christ. How do I teach those who keep the old covenant fourth commandment when Matthew 24:20 says, pray your flight be not on the Sabbath? Is this referring to Passover? No, it's any Sabbath. You see, what you're missing and what the subject there of Matthew 24 is, when you see the abomination of desolation standing where it ought not, flee Jerusalem. And he's saying, you know, pray that you're not pregnant during for that time, and also that it's not on a Sabbath. Why? Because under the law, the people of Israel were not allowed to travel any significant distance at all. So if the abomination of desolation were in Jerusalem and it was on the Sabbath, you wouldn't be able to get out of Judea. So that's what's being said there. Sorry, I had so much trouble reading your writing. Arthur in Maryland. And thank you for your kind comments. My question is, were we with God when he said, let us go down and confound their language, them being the sons of God? Yes, the angels are referred to as sons of God, not only there, but Genesis chapter 6, also Job chapter 1, verse 6. The sons of God means the angels. And of course, why were they doing that in Genesis 11, 7? Why would they want to confuse the language? You see, this was simply 200 years maybe after the flood of Noah's time. And you see, the people took it upon themselves that in the event that there was another flood, we'll create our own salvation. We'll build a tower. It became known as the Tower of Babylon, which means confusion. Let us go down and confuse their language. That's when God caused the people on earth to speak different languages. And of course, would the earth be flooded again? No, because God promised that it wouldn't be. Nancy, and I don't know where Nancy's from, please. What amount of time passes between the events of Genesis 1:27 and Genesis 2:7 and Genesis 2:22? Well, Genesis 1:27 is where God said, let us, referring to the sons of God, the angels, make man in our image. That was on the sixth day of the creation. Genesis 2:7 is where Eth Ha'adam in the Hebrew, the man Adam, was created by God, and that was on the eighth day. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 8 states that one day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, 1,000 years is one day. So 2 days could equate to 2,000 years difference. And then you asked on Genesis 2:22 is when Eve was created from the rib, which I think that the Hebrew is curve, and I think it was the helix curve that God took part of his DNA and created Eve. And it's not written. I would assume that that happened on the eighth day as well. I have a question. Who made Satan? I have learned so much from the word which you teach. Thank you very much, and you're welcome very much. We're glad you're learning and glad you're enjoying studying the word. Well, God created all souls, including that of Satan. You can document Satan was created in Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 12 and 13, where he's called the king of Tyre. That's also to chapter 28 of Ezekiel, where Satan is sentenced to death, to be turned to ashes from within, meaning he's going in the lake of fire, which is easily documented in the New Testament, Revelation chapter 20. Anna in Georgia, thanks to you and your staff for the hard work you do by teaching the Bible. And you're welcome, and thanks for remembering the staff. We have a very hard-working group of volunteers and staff members that get the job done when it comes to getting God's word out. Where in the Bible can I find Jabez's prayer? You'll find that in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 9 and 10, the prayer of Jabez. Betty in Iowa, please help me to understand, is God and Jesus two different people or persons or entities? Yes or no, so I can get this through my head. I'm 85 years old. It's time for me to know what's right. I thank you so much for all your help. God bless you. Well, thank you, Betty, and God bless you as well. You know, to answer your question, I'm going to go back to Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. And the prophet there said that a virgin will conceive, and you'll call his name Emmanuel. Emmanuel, if you translate it, means God with us. That's the answer to your question. Jesus was God in the flesh. And John chapter 1 verse 1 states in the New Testament, in the beginning was the Word, that's logos in the Greek language. The Word was with God, the Word was God. And you know, you hear us say at the end of every program that Jesus is the living Word. That's the logos. So if you read John 1 1 that way, in the beginning was Christ, and the Christ was with God, and Christ was God. You know, Trinity is something that a lot of people have understanding, trouble understanding, and I would suggest that you order CD 30574, Nature of God. And you know, it sometimes helps people to understand the Trinity by thinking about how many different offices does Satan have in the Bible. He was the serpent in the Garden of Eden. He's Lucifer. He's the devil. He's the dragon. He's the Antichrist. So just as Satan has different offices, your Heavenly Father has different offices as well. Tara in Georgia, in the first earth age, was there any spirit beings coexisting on earth with the dinosaurs? Yes, spirit man. Now don't be confused. I'm not saying flesh man, but spirit man, sons of God, were allowed on earth in the first earth age. You can document that in Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 26. But again, don't misunderstand or misquote me. I'm not saying man was in the flesh in the first age, earth age, but he was in the spirit. Lee from Ohio, and thank you for your kind comments, question. The word says it is appointed unto man to die once, and you'll find that in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. When Jesus returns and those of us still in the flesh are changed into our spiritual bodies, where is our death? Thank you for your answer. Good question. And I think the flesh, our flesh, will return to the earth from which it came. In other words, the flesh dies at that point, but the spirit lives on. The spirit, the flesh, let me say, is not transfigured such as Jesus was transfigured on Matthew chapter 17. Again, I believe our flesh will die, but our spirit man steps out of our flesh bodies in the twinkling of an eye, as Paul put it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, along about verse 52 in the following verses. Bob in Arkansas, in Mark 12:40, when Jesus is talking to the scribes, is he talking about them receiving damnation from taking tithes from widows who have no income? And what he states there is in verse 38 of Mark 12, Jesus speaking, he says, "Beware of the scribes, which devour widows' houses." So yes, I think that's exactly what Christ meant, was that those who browbeat widows who are on a fixed income and say, "You owe us 10%, a tithe, if you will, of whatever you get, the little bit you get to make ends meet and pay bills and buy groceries and prescription drugs, and but you got to give us 10%, or you're going to go to hell." That's damned. Those people need to be damned, because God would not have widows lose their houses so they could continue to pay 10% tithe to the church. The church should be taking care of the widows, not the widows taking care of the church. Gene in Georgia, one day with God is like 7,000 years. Let's correct that and say 1,000 years of our time. So when we go to the other side to help our family, is that time God's time or our time? Again, you're incorrect. It's 1,000. One day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. You know, in spiritual bodies, and that's what you're talking about when we go to the other side, and you're kind of confusing the other side. I think you're indicating the gulf. You say the gulf cannot be crossed, but after the Christ returns and we enter that millennial period, there's going to be a temple, and Christ will be in it along with the Zadok, the elect, those who don't worship the Antichrist. They will be allowed to leave the temple and go to an immediate family member to try and help them. And then your question, I'm sure, is about there's a penalty of 7 days that before they can enter back into the temple with Christ. Why? Because they're unclean. They've been in contact with the spiritually dead. And you're asking, will it be 7,000 years? That's where the 7,000 came from. 7 days equals 7,000 years. Or will it just be 7 days? In a spiritual body, time is irrelevant. Means very little. Mary in Nevada, where in the Bible does it refer to a rapist to be put to death? You'll find that in Deuteronomy 22, verse 25. The sentence for a rapist, the same who's for someone who commits premeditated murder, death, capital punishment. Tom in Mississippi, have you thought about the fact that Adam and Eve were not born of woman, and does this mean anything? I am not trying to be smart, just want to learn. Well, no offense taken, Tom. And I think what you're saying is that they weren't born, that perhaps that they are like the fallen angels because of that. But you see, they didn't leave their habitation, as it states in Jude chapter 1, verse 6, concerning the fallen angels. God created them and put a soul in them. So if you're confusing that with the fallen angels who refused to be born a woman, there's a big difference. God created them and put a soul in them. Jeanette in Virginia, how deep was the Red Sea when Moses and the Israelites crossed it? I heard on TV from preachers that it was a foot of water. But if this is so, how did the water drown the pursuing Egyptians? That's a good question. What we have here evidently is a preacher answering biblical questions who has no biblical knowledge. You see, it's very easy to figure that out. You go to Exodus chapter 14, verse 22, and you learn that Israel crossed the Red Sea on dry ground with a wall of water on their left and a wall of water on their right. And then in Exodus 14:28, after Israel, the children of Israel had cleared the Red Sea and were on the other side, then the Egyptian army pursued, the walls disappeared, and the waters came crashing down, destroying the armies of Pharaoh. Tiffany in Arizona, when an angel of the Lord is mentioned in the Bible, are they talking about God or a member of God's army? 99.9% of the time, when it states the angel of the Lord, it's the Lord himself. You see, the Lord exists in a different dimension than we exist in. And for us to see him in this dimension, he must manifest himself. Sometimes he manifested himself as a cloud to the children of Israel in the wilderness. Sometimes he manifested himself as a pillar of fire by night. Sometimes he manifested himself as an angel when he wrestled Jacob, for example. Angel of the Lord, you can pretty safe to say, the Lord himself. Linda in Oregon, I know when you go to heaven, you can only bring your works. You're right, Revelation chapter 14, verse 13, paraphrasing, when we die, your works are the only thing you can take with you, good or bad. So the people who don't have a lot of works would be almost naked. Wouldn't that be shameful? Yes, and that's the whole point. That's why we encourage people to do as we're instructed in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 14. Study to show thyself approved. And what do we study? We study the letter that God wrote to us. Workmen that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So if you want to, and what the Revelation 14:13 doesn't cover the part about the clothing, that you'll find in Revelation chapter 19, verse 8, that the righteous acts of the saint make up the linen that makes up their robes. Lenora in Alabama, where in the Bible is the word suicide mentioned? Please give me scripture in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. Well, I'm sorry to tell you, the word suicide does not appear in the King James Version Bible. We had an example, though, of one committing suicide recently in our study in Kings. In chapter 1 Kings chapter 16 verse 18, Zimri, one of the kings of the 10 tribes of Israel, when he realized he had met his Waterloo, committed suicide by burning the king's house down around him. Christine from Oregon, the book of Job really bothers me. If the Almighty God lets him suffer so much, I don't stand a chance. I'm very weak. Well, then toughen up. You know, God doesn't want servants who are going to faint at the first sign of trouble when they're delivered up before Antichrist. You see, Job had faith. Job means persecuted, if you translate it. And he knew God would reward his faithfulness, and God did. He ended up with double what he lost originally. And, you know, I guess Job had the faith in God. Do you have faith in God? And you know how to increase faith in God? It's written in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So get cracking, get opening the Bible is what that means, cracking the pages open and studying God's word. That's what allows you to mature as a Christian, and when you mature as a Christian, that's when you have a lot of faith. I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying our Father's word in depth. And you know what? When he looks down and he sees you cracking the pages of your Bible open, reading the letter that he wrote to you, it makes his day. And when you make his day, he's going to make your day. Blessings are bound to follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others of our brothers and sisters lost in this world of darkness. One thing that's most important, though, beloved, and it's this. You stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645. 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Deuteronomy. The law was given as our schoolmaster. Have you been to school on God's Word? Certainly one way to go there is to study the book of Deuteronomy. Probably the most exciting thing that Deuteronomy has to offer for you is that great song of Moses, that those that overcome the false Messiah in the end generation will be singing. The law itself being the schoolmaster that keeps us out of trouble in these flesh bodies. Again, an education in taming that part of you that oftentimes needs taming through the old schoolmaster, that great book, Deuteronomy, the law, and its set ways of keeping you from harm's way even in this generation. You're going to enjoy it.
Gravette, Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Praise God. We hope all of you that were here over the weekend, that you're back home safe and sound and ready to get back into our Father's Word. It was real good having you with us. Okay, we come to that hour that we study special studies in our Father's Word to document. You see, He did not leave us uninformed. It's simply that sometimes